Academy Award nominations were announced on Tuesday. Tonight, an Oscar review for the hour. Funding for Charlie Rose has been provided by the following.
For every drop of yourself you give, get every drop back. We offer over 80 ways to hydrate, energize, nourish, relax, or enjoy every drop of life.
Charlie Rose on PBS is brought to you in part by JPMorgan Chase, providing financial services and solutions to more than 30 million consumers, institutions, corporations, and governments worldwide.
Additional funding for Charlie Rose was also provided by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide. From our studios in New York City, this is Charlie Rose.
The Academy Awards will be held on February 25th in Hollywood. I spoke to more than a dozen of this year's nominees, and tonight we take a look at some of those conversations.
The nominees for Best Performance by an Actor in a Leading Role are Leonardo DiCaprio in Blood Diamond, Ryan Gosling in Half Nelson, Peter O'Toole in Venus, Will Smith in The Pursuit of Happiness, and Forest Whitaker in The Last King of Scotland.
Tell me what this is about. What's the story?
It's about a dirty old man and a young slut of a woman.
Slut of a woman.
That's right. which, of course, are the platitudes which are thrown at septuagenarians and men when they romance, to a certain degree, 19-year-old women. And if the 19-year-old women take some notice of them and they themselves are a bit slovenly in habit and they've been sexually promiscuous, you'd think of them as sluttish.
Yes.
So it is a look at those two platitudes of what can happen between an old man and a delightful young woman, a troubled young woman.
What brings them together?
We are actors. Yes. Richard Griffiths, whom you've mentioned, who's an old friend, and I'm delighted to have worked with him again, and we have many chuckles. Leslie Phillips, another old friend, and Leslie is 82.
Yes.
And as you can see, we had lots of good humour. And Vanessa Redgrave, my dear Vanessa Redgrave, a superb actress.
Which you had never worked with before.
I'd worked with her father. I'd worked with her mother. I'd worked with her brother. Her two children. Yeah. I'd worked with her sister, and I'd worked with her niece. I'd never worked with Big Van. So we were, and we've been friendly and argumentative for 50 years.
Yeah.
But it was great just to be with her and to do it again.
May
I just mention Jodie, please?
Yes, please.
Because it's very rare to find a young woman who is so not only accomplished and professional and charming, but who is so brilliantly talented. And not only that, she could be easily daunted by that list I gave you just then, and easily daunted by her film crew and everything. She took it with such boldness.
Playing amid legends, and she was okay.
She was a good kid. She really was. In fact, at the end of the first day, when you things like hair in the gate, you know, those various things. What's a hair in the gate? And she's asking wonderful questions.
For this man, who's an actor, who's a septuagenarian, as you said, have to figure out, where's he coming from? How do I get in his head? Who is he? What's his motivation? All those things that you do to hang your performance on.
The script sits in front of you.
Yes.
The writer has translated into ink what is in his spirit and his soul and his mind.
Boom.
I come along, I pick it up, and the ink goes into my eyes, into my mind, into my body, flows around.
Yes.
And that part begins to inhabit me. And I know good parts make good actors, Charles. And I know a good part when I see one. If you find a good part in a good play, that's double joy. No, it is everything that the author has done, whether or not the subjective attitudes towards a piece of work are valid or not, I don't know. But that comes in, and one's job really is to make the words flesh.
You have said before that it's not about an actor linking to his experience. It's about an actor using his imagination to link to his emotion.
That's exactly right. Exactly right.
So when it's stirring around in there, it's connecting to your emotion.
There are not very many good actors. There are thousands who are so described on their social security or whatever it is. Very few people can do it, and you may think that is a mercy. But very few people can do it. And the ones who can have this extraordinary attitude that the words, the part, is linked straight into one's own heart, immediately. One feels it and knows it immediately. And one finds it not easy, but eventually you will be able to express it. If you study, and by study, incidentally, the mechanical facts of study, as you go alone, and you bang and bang and bang, you try different things, different whatever, yes. But to plug into one's emotion is the most important thing.
Do you know why it is you love acting so much?
No, I don't. It's just that I was, listen, if your right hand finds something to do, do it with all your,
yes.
Right? I found it was something I could do. And then as I went on and on, I worked with some magnificent people when I was young. And the ones who I really adored were the people who adored the business. And they weren't the cliche old laddie actor, whatever. Mm. They were men who liked their rugby and they liked their cricket and they liked their politics and their discussions. Well, actors are people only more so.
Actors are people only more so. More so in terms of their enthusiasm for life, for everything? What?
Peopledom. Yeah. They're full of people.
Of character.
They're full of people. You've got dozens of people in us.
Waiting to get out.
Yeah.
Looking for a script that they can...
That's right. That's right. That's right. I didn't know that. But I'd done a few things. I'd been a fair sportsman. I could have even been a pro at one point.
Cricket.
Cricket and rugby. I tried my hand at newspaper. I was quite good. I was a good photographer. But nothing. And then I began to do this, and I began to be good at it. And to
pretty early, you were good at it.
I didn't know that, but I began to be considered good at it.
Yeah.
And then when people consider you are good at it,
you start, want to do more.
You want to do more.
Exactly.
And you start feeling good about it yourself.
Exactly.
And then I realized that this is what I learned. And I began to read about it and study it and the theatre history and the actors' history and what's gone on with our theatres all over the world for years. It's a great hobby of mine. And to have found this and to be able to earn my living by doing something which I love, I can't ask for more.
And you have no regrets?
Not a sausage.
Not a sausage, no.
Not no, look, I'm not a French chanteur,
yes,
so maybe I've got a couple of things that are regrettable.
Yes, there are a couple of things you didn't do. But there's no, and you don't have any regrets about how close you've come to an Oscar?
No. I mean, I feel disappointed.
Sure, of course. Disappointed. You've nominated how many times?
Seven.
What time that you didn't get it were you the most disappointed?
One of the things you should do if you want to know who's going to win an Oscar is to ring the Las Vegas bookies.
Yes.
They will give you fair odds. And they're very rarely wrong. The only time I was ever favorite was for The Lion in Winter.
Yes.
So it's the only time I had a bet on myself. And not only did I not get it, I also lost the money.
You didn't get it for Lawrence. You lost to whom?
I don't know.
Didn't get it for Beckett?
I don't look behind if I'm in a race or even if it's...
Yeah. They were once going to give you an honor or something, and you said, no, I'd like
no,
to earn it.
Yeah, I did. I did. I'd like to earn it. But that was an immediate response to something. And then it was pointed out to me very clearly by my children that that it was the highest honor that the film industry could pay one. And that to treat it with disrespect would be unconscionable. So I said, okay, kids, and I took it. And I loved getting it. That was good. But, you know, I do like to earn them.
Are you calling the bookies?
I will be.
So how do you get your hands on one hand, this awful criminal, and on the other hand, this engaging character?
Well, I think
who
we have
had
to
charm.
Yeah, no, I think there is a key there. I mean, you know, we can't dismiss him by talking about the other people who've done that, but we have to look at the character and nature of some of those people. And they have to have a certain degree of charisma in order to be able to capture a country, to capture a nation, to be followed with the kind of devotion that's necessary for them to take over a country like that. Mm. And that was, I think, one of the key elements to his character. And in effect, it was a key element to why the press never really reported for long periods of time about what was really going on in the country, because they were just seduced by this man, by his, what they would consider his buffoonery or his parties or his charm, what he was wearing. You know?
And do you think they didn't take him seriously?
I think
at the beginning
they didn't. I don't think he was taken seriously in the beginning enough. From the beginning, from the first moment the British maneuvered to get him into the presidency, to get a Boté out, so they wouldn't have a communist country. They were concerned about having a communist country. There's this communist bloc forming there, and I think they thought, okay, he was a soldier. He's followed us all these years. He'll just do what we tell him to do. We can control him.
And he was an independent spirit. Has anybody come to you and said, you know, in the end, this was a genocidal killer, you know, and why are we making a movie about him and glorifying him?
I mean, people have definitely spoken to me about the fact that
you're
not ignoring
so
the brutality. But, you know, it was interesting. In fact, I'm trying to see if I think I do. She just wrote a book. She won a Pulitzer last year. And, on genocide. Is there Sam? Samantha?
Samantha Power.
Yeah exactly.
She's at Harvard at Harvard for the...
Exactly. And I met with her. She saw the film. And she wanted to talk to me because she said, this is for her, it was one of the most true depictions of this type of a dictator. She said a number, and it's like when you meet them, there's a charm, there's a way of making you feel like you're one of the only people in the room, that you're invited into this secret place and stuff. So I was really interested in her response, and I think it's really important to know that these figures who we consider so dark can be this charming, or we won't be able to see them.
Tell me about this process.
Yeah,
of
I mean,
getting there. Mm-hmm. First, you got to understand the man and his passion.
Yes.
You got to figure out how you can communicate that.
Exactly. You get all this information, and you start working on the accent, the dialect, you know, the way he spoke to you, like I'm looking at it and listening to his meter, trying to get a key, you know, trying to get a clue into it, and working on the key Swahili to kind of train my mind and know that's my language. And then just studying the history, not just of Edie, but of the past leaders of Uganda, and then going and meeting all these people, his brothers, sisters, generals, ministers, soaking in Uganda in an organic way, like it's some sort of Eucharistic thing that you've eaten and it becomes a part of you, is what I needed it to be, so that it became an organic thing for me, so that his spirit would be able to sort of envelop me, because it was the spirit I was trying to find. Idi Amin is one thing. The spirit and the image and the myth of the way people think of this man is even larger than that. And so I was trying to embody that, and that took some internal work, really, going inside of myself.
And so how did you do that, and what did you find?
Internally?
Yeah.
I mean, I look for the places where inside of me that could be darker, the rooms inside of me that could be bigger, you know, that understood that this confidence in my place. And that's why some of those gestures and some of the things he did helped me, lowering my voice because I feel stronger, you know what I mean? And,
yeah.
But then also, like, looking for the darkness, not necessarily for some personal experience, but that feeling. And I think sometimes I was
trying to... sense of rage?
Yeah, that feeling. And making myself so passionate about certain things in one direction that it could set me off in something else. That just that thought of what you're saying and letting that build. And that took, like, a lot of... Sometimes meditative work by sitting still and, like, letting that build and build and build and living with the character pretty much most of the time I was there so that I could make that come out.
For best performance by an actress in a leading role, the nominees are Penelope Cruz in Bolvar, Judi Dench in Notes on a Scandal, Helen Mirren in The Queen, Meryl Streep in The Devil Wears Prada, and Kate Winslet in Little Children.
I want to keep feeling scared every time I start a movie. That's the way I feel. Like when we at the first day, the night before we shot Volver, I was crying in my bedroom. I felt like I was 8 years old again. And I love that feeling. And I feel that's what has me so addicted to acting, that I know the day that I'm 80, I can keep working. Fortunately, we have a lot of directors like Pedro that write for characters for women of all ages. And I will still feel this fear, you know, and I will always remember that you can always keep learning. As an actor, you never reach a place where you feel you know everything. That never happens. And that gives me real, real happiness. That's the part about the work that feels very real, that has nothing to do with the ego or fame or any of the other things that come with it, you know, that can last forever.
You're a young teenage girl in Madrid, watching lots of movies. He came to mean what to you?
He meant that dreams really, really can become true. You know, I grew up watching his movies, and it was my biggest motivation to try to become an actress was that dream, to be able to work with him one day. So I looked for an agent, I went to a theater school, and I made two movies, and he saw those movies, and when I was 17, he called me up, and I remember when I heard his voice, when I heard him say hello, I knew it was the beginning of a special and long relationship. I just knew it was going to be something very special in my life, and it was not only about the work we were going to do together.
What was it about the movies that you liked, that resonated with you?
Well, I felt there was this person, you know, in the time when I was a little girl, when my country was changing so much. I was born in 74, that's the year that Franco died, and all of those years it was like such a dramatic change. And I remember he was the representation of a freedom that... it was freedom, I didn't have to be tacky to be free, you know? And it was like, okay, I want to know who that person is. I'm so curious about the way he never judges his characters.
Yeah.
And I was able to appreciate that very, very young.
That he didn't judge his characters.
He didn't judge his characters.
He let them be.
Yes, because, I mean, it was like in everything that happened in those years, everyone thought, okay, now we can express ourselves. So that meant like everyone had to be running around naked, and it was just about that. And then he did that in a very different way, and you can only do it that way if you have the talent that he had. And he did a lot for my country, just not for the movies, but I think he affected people's lives in a huge way, and he did with mine. So it was not only about the movies, it was so much more. I felt like I really can smell this person's soul, and I want to get to know him, you know. And it's amazing everything that has happened.
I mean, can you say that he is the single most important person in your professional career?
Yes, because, I mean, I have a lot of people in my career that have given me great opportunities and that I love very much and I feel very grateful, But I feel he's almost like a family member also, you know. And yeah. And when those things, when you have that much trust for somebody and those two things can go together and the huge admiration that I feel for him. I've done like 35 movies now, and there are, as I said before, many directors that I love. I feel very grateful to everything that I've learned with them. But it's true, I have this special relationship with him that is also a personal thing.
Tell me about playing this queen who's alive and these events are recent.
Well, the most intimidating, of course, most terrifying prospect. The only thing that made it palatable was the fact that Stephen was directing and Peter Morgan was writing it.
And why did it make it palatable that Stephen was directing?
Because they were a team who'd already done an incredible piece called The Deal, which was about the background to the Gordon Brown-Tony Blair relationship before Tony Blair came into power. And it was a brilliant piece of work on every level. The acting, the writing, the tone of it was very, very good, serious but kind of comedic. So at least I felt that I was in safe hands, because it's a hot potato in England.
You read every biography?
I read every biography. Robert Lace's was very valuable. And actually the one that I found the most valuable was a book that was written by her nanny when Margaret and Elizabeth were from an age of about 3 to about 18. They had this nanny called Crawfy, something Crawford, what was her name? Kind of terrible, I can't remember. Yeah. Anyway, she was known as Crawfy. And she, and when she was let go, she suddenly found herself without employment, and wrote a book about her experience. And it was considered to be a most appalling betrayal, but it was very valuable. Although it's a rather sycophantic book, actually it gave great
totally
insights.
Totally in praise of the Queen.
Well, the Queen is a little girl at that point. She's not a queen. Yeah. You know, she hasn't become queen when Crawfy writes a book. She has no possibility of becoming
queen.
Now,
why was that the most valuable book? Because you understood what she'd gone through and therefore...
No, because I understood then her background, her upbringing, and also, much more important, the nature of the personality of the person before she became the monarch.
So what... go ahead.
No, just so her true character, as opposed to the character that she had to embrace along with the job kind of thing. So it was that I kind of looked at a lot.
For all this reading from watching, help us understand, which we will see in a minute, in your portrayal.
Well, that inner sense of responsibility, I think, that came, I think she had long before she became the Queen. And there was one little tiny piece of film that I watched over and over again of her when she was about 12 years old, getting out of a car and meeting a dignitary, as a posh little girl doing a posh girl's job, you know. But she does it with such gravitas and seriousness, and I've got to do this right, you know. And there's no smirking, and there's no... you know, aren't I cute, or, you know, aren't I lovely, or aren't I rich and posh?
It's duty, duty, duty.
It's just duty, and she had that, I think she had that naturally as a young girl. You see her with her sister Margaret in those funny, you know, films, and she's always looking after Margaret, saying, come on, but not in a bullying or control freak way, sort of helping her along, saying, well, we've got to go this way now, and no, don't run there, and, you know, we've got to be quiet now. So she's got that sense of responsibility. I don't know anything about Diana. I haven't studied her. I haven't read my research books. And anyway, I think because the whole issue of Diana was so... so loaded in terms of celebrity, in terms of the press, in terms of the public falling in love with her, falling in love with an image of her. I think it'll take a long time for us to discover the truth, quite honestly. And I don't want to make any judgments either way.
She's lost control of her life and herself and who she is. She can't remember who she once was, and she's desperately trying to get back to that person, but she's forgotten who that person was in the first place. And I think the truth is I do know women like this, you know, and I overhear conversations in the playground myself, very similar to the conversations that you hear in this movie, in the playground by the swing set with the other mothers. You know, it was difficult to play somebody who, you know, on the surface is nothing like me, but in actual fact, through shooting this film and playing this character and understanding who she was, I think I realized that in actual fact, there's so much of her that has been me at various different times of my life. You know, Sarah's very much the, you know, she's not she's not necessarily a beauty. She doesn't have particularly good dress sense. She has absolutely terrible hair, so on and so forth. And she's the kind of girl who didn't get asked to dance at the prom, you know. And the truth is, I was like that. I never, you know, I never got the boys. I was never thought of as pretty or attractive or anything like that. And, you know, was nervous of life in many ways. And and I think that's a lot of Sarah too. And so it was just interesting in terms of building who she was and the preparation that I was doing for myself. I kept coming up with things where I'd go, okay, I might not like to admit this, but in actual fact, yeah, I've been there. I've been that person. I've felt emotionally stifled like she feels in this film. And it was hard to sort of revisit some of that stuff in myself. And
but also good, I assume, because it gave you some place to access something that you could
It did in a strange way. It was kind of weirdly therapeutic, I think, even though I didn't necessarily realize that at the time. It's kind of only now talking about it that I kind of go, oh, yeah, okay, I got that out of my system then, maybe. But it was an enormous challenge. You learn so much as an actor that you want to keep learning more and more, and I think the day that I sit up and say, oh, I know how to do this now, is really the day that I should consider stopping, because you can never know enough. You know, I would never claim to know everything about acting. It's not possible. And I feel I very much need direction and guidance from my director. And I absolutely had that with Todd Field. I mean, because he's an actor too, you know, his understanding of what the actor has to go through in order to, you know, go those emotional lengths and become that other person, the support and the sort of sense of your hand being held was so strong on this film, and it was a really wonderful collaboration. I mean, actors, you know, you hear that actors say that a lot, you know, this was a great collaboration and blah 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 blah, but it really was something else. You know, I'd have lots of late night telephone calls with Todd where he would suddenly call me and say, you know, have you looked at the scene for tomorrow? And I would say, well, yeah, obviously, of course. He said, well, what do you think? And I'd say, well, what do you mean, what do I think? He'd say, well, don't you think it's too long? And I would say, well, actually, since you ask, perhaps, you know, we could trim it down a little bit here and there. He'd say, well, how, where, what should we do? What do you want to change? And I'd be like, me? Why are you asking me? Yeah. And part of the actor's job, I think, well, certainly for me, is, you know, you have to put your trust in the director, and you have to basically do what they want you to do, you know. Even if sometimes you might quietly disagree, it's very much a part of the job to comply with the director's every wish. I really do feel like that. And, you know, luckily for me on this, you know, I agreed with so much of what Todd wanted all the time. And if I didn't know what to do sometimes in a scene, I also knew that I could turn to him and say, oh, give me an idea, help me. I'm, you know, I'm stuck. I don't know how to play this. Just tell me. And he would always
come
out
with an idea.
These little gems that were so helpful. That's one of the things about acting that I love so much, is that there is no right or wrong. That you can, sometimes you can just play and just see what happens. And I think the sense of mystery that's involved in every single day of shooting is just so glorious. It really is so glorious. And you have to be confident and brave enough to make mistakes as well. You know, sometimes it's not always going to go according to plan. Sometimes you might do something that's just not very good, and you have to be brave enough to make that mistake in front of a crew of people who you, you know, barely know sometimes. And it's just all about experimenting, and we very much had that on Little Children, very much so.
Easier to do that on film than on the stage, because you can be edited on film.
Oh yeah, absolutely. You know, on film, at least you can stop in the middle and say, no, this is all going very badly. Right. Let's just start again.
You or, can't or do the that director on stage. Can come back the next day.
Yeah. Yes. Exactly. You know. The dialogue was so natural. You know, you just feel like those two people are chit-chatting, having a conversation. Almost feels like it could have been improvised. But every line of dialogue was scripted for that particular scene. And we shot that in one day. And I was thinking, yeah, I remember this was the moment when both the kids threw up. And I'd said to them before we shot the scene, I said, okay, is there going to be breaks? Because, you know, swinging these three-year-olds for 3-4 hours, they are just going to be sick. And everyone was like, oh, no, I'm sure they'll be absolutely fine. One after the other. But I was also remembering how nervous I was shooting that scene, because it's so pivotal. I mean, it's such an important scene. At the end of it, what happens, and I am going to tell what happens at the end of that scene.
Yes.
Sarah, she goes to him and she says, one of those women over there bet me $5 that I couldn't get your phone number. And then they realize that she doesn't have a pen, and then Sarah decides to take it one step further, and she says, you know what would really freak them out? And they kiss. They kiss. And this is the first time these people have ever met in their lives. And it's the beginning of the rest of the movie. So I knew that nailing that scene was possibly more important than any other scene in the film, any of the nude scenes, any of the scenes towards the end where it becomes very highly charged and very emotional. That scene for me was absolutely everything, because it's the springboard to everything that happens every step of the way beyond that. It's the beginning of their erotic affair.
Nominees for Best Performance by an Actress in a Supporting Role are Adriana Barraza in Babel, Cate Blanchett in Notes on a Scandal, Abigail Breslin in Little Miss Sunshine, Jennifer Hudson in Dreamgirls, and Rinko Kikuchi in Babel.
But with Notes on a Scandal, it was definitely the chance to work with Judy that clinched it for me. I'd read the novel, but then a lot of interesting novels make terrible films.
Which Notes of a Scandal is about a relationship between you, a teacher, and a young student. Mm. But in fact, it's a relationship about two women.
The salacious aspect of it is obviously the sex with a minor. But I think that's just it's just a catalyst, really, for this really unsavory friendship, if you can call it, that develops over this this scandal, the secret.
Kid that you're a teacher and that's a student in your school.
And it's something that is really beyond my comprehension. And
maybe you never understood why she would do it.
Why, no. Why anyone who's 35 would go out with a 20-year-old? I don't even understand that. what do you talk about? So for me, once they open their mouths and it's not very interesting, it's no amount of physical attraction.
So what did you do to convince us this might have happened?
Well, it does happen.
Of course it does, yes.
It happens repeatedly. And I think it's interesting the way the law deals with women and men in quite different ways. It's always the male, no matter how old, that seems to be the sexual aggressor. And I think I just had to liberate Sheba from my own sense of morality, really. I mean, in the end, you don't want to patronize an audience. And once I understood it as somebody who had never really had an adolescence, who had gone from being a good teenager into being a good wife and trying to do the best thing as a mother, that the desire to sort of combust, I think, was really powerful. And that's the sort of the place that I started from.
For best foreign film language, we have from Denmark, After the Wedding. From Algeria, Days of Glory. From Germany, The Lives of Others. From Mexico, Pants Labyrinth. And from Canada, Water.
You know, I love the movies to be almost like parables, but in a fairy tale way. So I'm always thinking in those terms. If there's not a monster on my call sheet, I won't show up to shoot. There has to be a monster.
Has to be a monster.
I'm in love with monsters.
You were, is that because of your childhood?
Yeah, absolutely.
You saw a whole lot of bad things.
I saw a lot of things. Yeah.
You know, in terms of murder and
not only that, but I had
violence.
I had a lot of what is called lucid dreaming.
Yeah.
Which is another form of schizophrenia, I hope. For example, when I was a kid, at midnight in the guest room in my grandmother's house, at midnight, a fawn would come out from behind the armoire. Right at midnight, when the church was striking midnight, I would see the hand first, and then the goat face, and then the goat leg, and I would start screaming. And it was every night I slept in that room. I would go to sleep at 9, and I would wake up, or not wake up, at 11:30, 11:40, until midnight stroke, and it came out.
When I went to Sri Lanka, because we shot it, Water in Sri Lanka, I put notices out in all the local schools. And Sarala was one of the girls who came for an audition. And she came with her father, her mother, her cousins, and I mean, about 10 of them, the whole family arrived, of course. And she sat there in a little red dress and two long pigtails with red ribbons, and she smiled, and I looked at her and I said, oh my God, this is Chuya. Like you said, you know instinctively that this is the kid for you and your film. And so I started talking to her, and about 10 seconds into my monologue, I mean, I realized that she didn't understand a word of what I was saying. In dumb me, I mean, the kid doesn't understand, obviously. Mm. She doesn't understand Hindi. She's from Sri Lanka. She doesn't understand English because Sinhalese is her language. And but there was something about her, and I said, we'll deal with it. And we did, you know, 3 weeks of rehearsal. She learned her lines phonetically. When we were attacked by Hindu extremists and the film was shut down, after getting the requisite permissions, of course, I mean, you can't make a film in India, I'm sure you know this a lot, till you get permission from the Indian government, mm-hmm. and you have to submit your script, and they go through it and scrutinize it. And if they feel that there's anything detrimental, they don't give you permission. And they said, oh, fine, everything's fine. They sent us off, and we were prepping in pre-production with the film, with water, for 6 weeks in Varanasi. And because it's a period film, we had to construct period sets. And also, I mean, this is an independent film. It's not a big studio film. So we didn't have a huge budget. And every penny that we had, actually, we put in the sets and in the wardrobe and to get authenticity. And so when the Hindu extremists from the RSS, they identified themselves, which is a right-wing Hindu extremist party, attacked the sets and threw them into the river. And basically, the death threats and, you know, bomb blasts on jeeps and effigies being burnt. And I mean, it was what we call in, there's a word in Hindi which is called a tamasha, which really describes what it was like.
Like a spectacle.
Like a spectacle. And it was flexing of muscles of the fundamentalists and who want to be perceived as the great protectors of the religion, of course.
In the category of best achievement in directing, Alejandro Gonzalez Inarritu for Babel, Martin Scorsese for The Departed, Clint Eastwood for Letters from Iwo Jima, Stephen Frears for The Queen, and Paul Greengrass for United 93.
I think the films that I have done are the same films. I mean, saying that I think the obsessions that I have been exploring in the three films, deals with reality and explore that vulnerable and fragile, relation between parents and children. So that's what Amores Perros is about, and about 21 Grams and the same Babel,
right.
Basically. So, and I approach my approach.
Babel is about children?
It's about parents and children. I think the four stories, even when they have this political or social comment in it, and in a global scale, at the end are four intimate stories about parents and children. So, I mean, the four of them are about that very complex relation that we have. So I think, and my approach is more real. It's realism what I'm really, really interested in until now. So, for example, I don't know how they do what they do. So in a way that I admired, because I don't have to do nothing with monsters or fantasy. there's no room for fantasy sometimes in my films, and I would love to explore that. But one thing is what you want to do, and one thing is what you can do. And that's what my abilities are, but that's my world that I want to explore.
Picture making is telling characters, telling stories and letting characters unravel for everybody to analyze, and then with maybe the ironies of what you're alluding to is that there's winners and there's losers, but there's no real winners in this situation, because though Japan in losing did what I think everybody would dream certain people now would dream they could do for Iraq, is they could democratize it and become a huge economical power, but the Japanese people are tremendously innovative and tremendously energetic, and they made a lot out of it. Everybody hopes that the world could expand like that and progress like that, but we gotta wait and see.
You want people though to see this as an anti-war film.
Oh, absolutely. I didn't set out to. I certainly didn't set out to glamorize either side of it. I know I grew up with the, and I'm sure you've seen most of them too, the very propagandistic films in World War II. The enemy was always terrible, kind of like you were saying earlier. And it turns out that their side had the same propaganda about us. The horrible Americans coming on, and so everybody had the propaganda.
Savages, they say.
Yeah, and everybody learns about it learns otherwise as they sort of mature. But yeah, it's I don't want it to be a pro-war thing, and I don't want to show the violence of war or any part of it as being a glamorous, happy, fun-loving thing. I've been in
just with the glorification of heroes.
Yes, I mean, I've been in films in my early career where I had the smart dialogue and could pick somebody off of the tower with a rifle. But
make my day.
Yes, exactly, and that that was fun at that particular time. But it's not what I'm interested in telling now. And I think the fact that the violence of war is very painful.
What are you interested in telling now, beyond this story?
I'm just mainly interested in showing, approaching subjects that I haven't done before, and that maybe that haven't been made, at least that don't follow a pattern particularly. I'm not looking to follow it, to stay in genres particularly. I'm sure the next film I'll do will be some fit in, if you want to call it a genre, some other genre or something else. I really don't know. Every story, the last four movies I've done, Mystic River and Million Dollar Baby and then Flags and Letters, have all had a little different twist. They've kept it interesting for me, has kept me challenged, and I think hopefully there's other pieces of material out there that are challenging as well.
The day after Diana died, she chose not to speak publicly. Blair spoke publicly because he just thought that was expected of him.
Of course
she did. Chose not to speak publicly for her own reasons.
Which were?
That Diana's family had asked for a private funeral, that she wasn't any longer a member, that Diana was no longer a member of the royal family, that somehow, if all this nonsense was going to be going on in the press, she shouldn't be part of that sort of circus.
Well, she could have done this without it being a circus. Come on, I mean, she could have acted
not
with...
really. Not really. And then as the events of the week, as all the people came out with the flowers and, you know, candles and everything, it became more like a circus and drove her into an isolated position. The truth is that Diana's arrival in the royal family must have caused such turbulence. Well, we know it caused turbulence, but it must have been so shocking for them all.
Because she was so young and beautiful, because she was so modern,
because she was so modern,
different.
Because she was so modern.
Yeah.
And because she was like a sort of movie star and,
yeah,
you know, like pop music and Versace and the things that my daughter likes.
She liked, and she was of that.
Yes, absolutely.
Or certainly became of
absolutely.
That, too.
And then, I mean, personally, I think the royal family behaved rather badly towards her. And yeah. I think the marriage was the real problem.
What is it about this thing of filmmaking that turned you on the most? What part of problem solving, what part of it? I mean, you sat as we watched this,
yeah,
and we watched the scene of the, yeah, you know, and you said to me, as you said earlier in the conversation, you know, it's hallucinatory because you're here and here and here and all these lights and mm-hmm. things are going on. Mm-hmm. You got rock music and you got the all kinds of stuff happening. And yet you plotted that out.
Yes.
I said storyboard, you said no. Miniaturization of storyboard.
Miniaturization of storyboard.
Yeah.
Now, yeah.
But what is it about this process that, is it the editing? Is it creating the scene?
For me, if first of all, you need the story, you need the script to be there. You need the script to be there. You need it to be on the page in terms of the emotion and in terms of something with which the audience can empathize in terms of characters. You need the audience to care about somebody. Okay, that's one thing. So we've been taking over the years, we've been pushing the envelope on that, though, over the years with Mean Streets, Taxi Driver, Raging Bull, and particularly Raging Bull, and even Goodfellas and Casino. So we're pushing the edge there. How much can you care for a person if he's this bad or if she's that bad, you know? And can you still care? There's some out there I know can still care, so that's pretty good. Okay, now let's see if we can push a little more. Now, the only thing for me, though, is that that's one thing. That's got to be on the page. But then for me, it's literally the imagining of shots, one shot being cut to the other and the emotional and psychological impact of that cut and the movement of that cut. In other words, two shots together, two moving shots together, create another movement altogether in your mind that isn't there.
As a filmmaker, you have to tell a story to the audience.
And in so doing, you have to translate it through an image, which means that you direct the eye and the heart to look in a certain way, the way you want it to be, the way you want them to see it. And I never saw anybody tell a story that way. Pretty much every one of the films, you can study the shots. First of all, you don't go study the shot. You go look at the movie, and it affects you or it doesn't affect you.
Yeah.
They affected me. And then I went back. When I began to learn more about filmmaking, I went back, and I kept saying, why is that one so powerful? Why is it so powerful? And I went back, and I tried to trace backwards the shots. And then eventually, you know, eventually it was, I started making films before there was video. So yeah. I had to do this going from theater to theater, you know. So it was a different thing. I was trying to write down notes.
Yeah.
So why does something stay with you for so many years? Why did the tracking shots and Paths of Glory stay with you? It's really a person with a very strong, powerful storytelling ability, talent, genius, who could create a solid rock image that has conviction. Yeah. And that is the image. What's in that frame stays in that frame. What isn't in the frame is out. I guess over the years I made it for different reasons, sometimes just to be able to do the process, to relearn how to make a picture. In some cases, yeah. When the industry changed, for example, and the type of film I was making in the early 80s was not accepted that much in Hollywood anymore, I went back and did independent film, After Hours, and then upped it again a year later with movie stars, Paul Newman and Tom Cruise and Color of Money, to try to learn if I could survive. It's really experimenting, even to Cape Fear, seeing if I could do a film that, I don't know, that has another reason for being, rather than... it's really a learning process for me, more than anything else, and still fit within some sort of commercial framework, and that was the dangerous part. And this is extraordinary, you know. It's to hear this for the first time too. I didn't know anything. I really had never spoken before, you know. So it's really interesting because you're right. You have to wait for a story that's worth telling.
The films nominated for Best Picture of 2006 are. Babel, Alejandro Gonzalez Inarritu, John Killick, and Steve Golin, producers. The Departed, nominees to be determined. Letters from Iwo Jima, Clint Eastwood, Steven Spielberg, and Robert Lawrence, producers. Little Miss Sunshine, nominees to be determined. And The Queen, Andy Harris, Christine Langan, and Tracy Seward, producers.
In Babel, I was completely panicked because this film took me 1 year to shoot, basically. And I was shooting some things in Morocco, and then that I know that it will be together with something that I would shoot almost one year later in Japan.
Yeah.
And when I was shooting in Japan, I forgot what I shot there. So it was like puntillism, that I was creating little mosaics, and I was trying to get something that make a whole film. And that, for me, that the key that Babel works, if it works, is because there's a theme. That joined. There's no physicality links, but it's in a spiritual, thematically, emotionally.
Yeah.
But it's about that. It's
totally.
To be putting things.
Yeah.
And then when I saw the first time that thing, you know, then you find the things that you want to say, but you have to be working in the micro, and then to reveal at the end in the macro spectrum what is there.
But you have one central character, one really central character in Letters.
Yes.
And in American Story, Flags of Our Fathers, you have three, but more even.
Right.
And they're all unknown characters, whereas he is so central to everything that takes place in the second film.
Yes. Mm. Yeah, there's the young conscriptee who goes out. We sort of see the general through his eyes.
Now, where did that character come from? Did that idea come from the scriptwriter or where?
Well, it came from the screenwriter.
Yeah.
Iris had him, and several, because she wanted to see it through the young people's eyes, and the general is sort of a bigger than life character, there's a lot of very accurate things. The dissension between some of the generals and admirals about the technique of defending the island was all true. General Kurabayashi was knew more about America than a lot of other Japanese officers did because he had been an envoy here in the late 20s, early 30s as a young man, and studied English up in Boston at Harvard, and then went to Canada and was envoy there for a while. he knew America, and he actually enjoyed his time here, and he was also a person who didn't advocate going to war. He thought that America was too big a industrial complex to possibly go to war with. So from a practical standpoint, he didn't think it was wise.
You met members of his family?
Yes, I did. I met some. There's an Iwo Jima association in Tokyo that has members of Baron Nishi, who is one of the characters in the islands, yeah. Who won the Olympics, gold medal in the Olympics in equestrian. His son is a member of that, and Kuribashi's grandson, and everyone. There's a large group of people, of veterans who keep the memorial alive.
Interesting in war, and you made two films from both sides, and you see courage, and you see a range of human emotion. In war, we tend to demonize our enemy.
Sure.
And not see any sort of redeeming value or character in them, and not understand or appreciate or think about the fact they have families, they have lives, and
right.
That they have character and courage as well.
Sure. Their mothers feel the same heartache as American mothers do when they get that information that their sons are no longer coming back, or the husband's no longer a chance of them coming back. It's the same emotions. It's just a little bit different culture, between the two films together, I was trying to be an anti-war statement. Yeah, it's hard to make any war picture and make it a pro-war statement.
Yeah.
It's just not. You always wish that mankind would reach the level of intelligence that they could avoid it, but history doesn't prove out that at the present time.
Yeah.
We started talking about an approach, and Tom had some ideas in terms of different things that would be germane strictly to the script, as did I, and we got together. He lives outside of Cambridge. We got together in a hotel room in Boston and just sort of
You live in Maine, up. He lives in Cambridge, and so you could work it out.
Right, yeah.
And you just hold up and work it out and talk about it? And
yeah, we spend 2 or 3 days just sort of talking about maybe a way in, and then we just got down to writing and walking it
together.
Mm-hmm.
How difficult is that, though? I mean,
in this case, it wasn't difficult at all, because you get up and you start to play with each other. You start to dance with each other and play scenes. And
what about this? Does this work here?
Does this work here? Does this work there? Wait a minute, I have an idea. Just let me get it down. Okay, let's read it.
As we started animating the cars, we had these test cars early on in the development of the movie. The animator started really bending the cars around. And one of the things that I always do is I was excited about the idea of doing cars as characters in our medium of computer animation, because I knew that we could make the chrome look like chrome, the metal flake paint look like metal flake. We could really make it look like it looks almost real.
We thought that the approach of this film, even though the canvas is way bigger and the production value way bigger, the approach would be the same as Si Tu Mamá También.
Yeah.
That meant that character is as important as social context. So you don't do close-ups because you don't want to favor character versus context. So you keep kind of a distance, so character blends with environment. And then you don't do editing to seek for an effect. What you try to do is to create a moment of truthfulness in which the camera is there just to register that moment of truthfulness.
Let me see your notebook.
Oh, yes. It's the current one.
You keep a notebook all the time.
All the time.
And you write ideas. This is what all of your work comes from.
Yes, all of it. Yeah. It's recorded somewhat or another there, or sometimes personal little anecdotes, or I hear these guys or somebody talk, say a phrase, and I write it down.
Thank you for joining us. We'll see you next time.
Funding for Charlie Rose has been provided by the following.
For every drop of yourself you give, get every drop back. We offer over 80 ways to hydrate, energize, nourish, relax, or enjoy every drop of life.
Charlie Rose on PBS is brought to you in part by JPMorgan Chase, providing financial services and solutions to more than 30 million consumers, institutions, corporations, and governments worldwide.
Additional funding for Charlie Rose was also provided by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide.
We are PBS.